Your hair is looking good, though.
Man, thanks, brother. You know, you and I with some sober sleep last night, I woke up pretty happy, pretty pumped up.
Let's speak for yourself.
I'm in an okay mood right now, so I'm ready to go.
I'll post the videos. I got woke up by the 2-year-old at 6 in the morning with just like, he does the, he screams just da-da until I go get him. That's it. It's like I'm just a servant. And I go in there and he's like, take me out of here. I'm like, oh, bro, show me a little respect. We have a top 25 NBA podcast in the world. And he's like, I don't care.
That's in the Bay Area. Number one Warriors podcast in the Bay.
Yeah, he just looks at me. He's like, you're nothing to me.
He's telling you to fuck off. That's disrespectful.
For sure.
You
know he's so going to be a player avi troll. Like I'm so disappointed.
Don't say that.
I'm so disappointed. He's gonna be 13 on Twitter making the version of me just like you know freak out. Anyway, I can't even imagine if I was a kid coming up in this climate and like anyway, different conversation.
Sometimes I wonder. I mean, you listen to Simmons' podcast. He doesn't have his son on, but he has his daughter on sometimes and.
Bold,
I'm like,
bold.
Yeah,
move.
Right. I'm like, I don't know. You know, that's a long way for you and I. So it's a long way. We don't got.
I hope so. All right, we'll get this going. Let's tell people to come in here. You ready? You ready?
I'm ready to roll.
I'm feeling pretty good about.
Are we gonna do some Niners at the end? Or are we not gonna do some Niners at the end? 5 minutes of Niners at the end. You know me. I'm always trying to. I do have the sleeper read ready to go, by the way. I do have it ready to go today.
I'm not going to say no if you start. I'm not going to, like, shut the stream down. So we'll leave it at that. All right. Presented by Sleeper Fantasy, welcome to Light Years. Andy Liu, Warriors 2-1, 106-95 win over the Houston Rockets. I'm pretty encouraged by this game because, you know, they won. It got a little tight down the stretch. At one point during it, I wasn't feeling so great. But, you know, Draymond Green is back. Chris Paul came off the bench. I think the vision was on display tonight. The execution wasn't fully there, but you don't expect the execution to be fully there on October 29th. I'm leaning into this going, I can see what this Warrior team is trying to build, and it kind of matches, like, basically what I was trying to sell you all offseason.
Yeah. Yeah. Everything you tried to sell me on has been like the process has been right. Like they've been doing the right things. They haven't just been saying it now. They're doing the right things. Now, to your point, the execution has been hit or miss. I mean, this game was a tie game, right? They were down 2 with 5 minutes to go. So
yeah.
Execution's been hit or miss. They lost game 1, stuff like that. But I think most importantly, let's start at the front, dude. Chris Paul came off the bench. I mean, that's I think is huge. I know you thought that was going to happen the whole time. I didn't. And the Draymond injury kind of put that on. They postponed it a little bit. But I thought that was pretty big tonight. I know it's game 3. It's after a Niners game. It's football Sunday. Nobody's really paying attention. Nobody really cares. But Chris Paul came off the bench tonight. He played 27 minutes. He didn't really even get to close the game when the game was like truly, truly a close game. So I thought, and of course the Warriors win, so he doesn't really get to complain, but I thought that was a pretty good sign for the Warriors.
I think so too. And you know, Draymond's on a minutes restriction. He played 20 minutes. That's kind of what I thought he was going to play. It's probably gonna be a few games until they work it out. But, you know, yeah, to the point, my thought all year had been, obviously he wants to start. Why would he not want to start? But he's not going to say no to coming off the bench. And then it really comes down to if it works. If it works, he can't say shit. Like, Andre Iguodala did not want to come off the bench, but they started 16-3. They were 22-4. Like, they got off to such an absurd start. He's obviously a team guy at heart, and he wants to win. What is he going to say? And that's kind of the gamble the Warriors are making here. You know, if they go 5-7, you best believe Chris Paul is going to start leaking that he should be starting. But they're 1-0 with him off the bench. And if they go, you know, 8-2, 10-3, that type of thing, like, he's not going to make noise. He knows he's professional enough to know how uncouth that is.
Yeah. It's still surprising, though. You know, it's almost year 20 for him, and he's willing to do that. And I think even more importantly, and by the way, the box score right in front of us, Chris Paul was a team-high plus 22. We'll get to the bench unit kind of blowing this game open and making sure that the Warriors can win this one. He also didn't get to close the game. I know he played like the last 2 minutes of the game. But before that, that was before the game got kind of out of reach, the Warriors played their standard closing lineup. It was Draymond and Looney along with Steph, Clay, and Wiggins at the wing spot. So I thought that was interesting to monitor as well. This Houston Rockets team is super athletic, right? Just guys that were flying. Jalen Green,
the exact type of team you'd think would be like an issue for an older Warriors team.
And they were. The Warriors really couldn't get anywhere with these guys. So I think that's interesting to monitor. Like you just said, though, Warriors are now 2-1. Kind of ugly a little bit, but they're 2-1. And they start a road trip 2-0. So as long as they keep winning, it's all good. And I'm waiting, Sam. I don't know when it's going to happen. Maybe it won't work out because you don't want those guys on the floor together. But I am waiting for Draymond and Chris Paul, like, amped up together on the floor at the same time doing goon shit. I am waiting for that in a big game.
They are the same guy in terms of just, like, their heart and, like, their basketball soul. In all the best and the worst ways. By the way, if you are new to Playback, joining us for the first time live, make an account. It's free. And then you can type in the chat. We can bring you on stage. Just sign in. Okay. So the biggest story of this game was Chris Paul coming off the bench. The proxy biggest story was starters played poorly, and the bench unit was amazing.
Yeah.
Let's do a second on the starters, because as far as I'm concerned, it's more rust than anything for Draymond in there, but and Clay was excellent. This was like his first, like, okay, he's starting to get out of that little preseason slump. I thought he looked really good. But Wiggins was bad. But beyond that, it's like, to me, it's just kind of like the starters. Let's give them a few games before we, like, make comments about this lineup.
You're just going to skirt over the Wiggins? You're just going to skirt over the Wiggins?
There's like four different angles on it. But, like, in general, yeah, okay, we'll start there. Like, in general, I'm like, all right, Draymond's first game back. Guys figuring out where they fit around him. A little rusty. Like, I'm not going to overread into the lineup itself being bad.
Yeah, I agree. Steph also was cakewalking through three quarters. I mean, dude, somebody tweeted that he didn't take a shot at the rim. It didn't look like he even wanted to step inside the 3-point line. He didn't even want to shoot the ball. It kind of makes sense. He came into the game questionable/probable, had a foot injury. He's going to play tomorrow, it looks like, unless he comes out of this game injured. Don't look like it in the fourth quarter, right? So, looked like he was trying to take it easy. And then when the Warriors went up 16, felt like Steph was like, okay, let me see if I can pace myself, right? The dude's, how many times we got to say it? The dude's 35. He's trying to pace himself. And then all of a sudden the game's tied. They're down 2 in the fourth quarter. So he kind of has to show up. But I do kind of, you know, if you're kind of has to point a finger and the starter's not playing well for three quarters, right? Kind of Steph is the guy that they need to play those minutes. But Andrew, it's three games now for Andrew Wiggins. It is the shot's ugly. He's a good above-average three-point shooter. That thing is not close to going in.
Three straight years, he's been about 38%+ for the Warriors. You can't say he can't shoot the ball.
He can definitely shoot the ball, but the thing is not going in right now. He's not attacking the rim. And look at these zeros. Again, we have the box score up here. I am fascinated, appalled.
Minnesota Wiggins right now. Zero rebounds, zero assists, zero steals, zero blocks.
That's impressive, actually. Like, it's impressive.
It's Minnesota Wiggins. And by the way, I'm looking at the schedule. Here's my prediction. He's going to continue playing like this until they play Minnesota on...
When do they play him?
November?
Don't say late November.
It's not late November. November 12th.
Okay.
My prediction is he'll have a 35-5-4, three-steal, two-block game, that type of thing, and then he'll be back. That's my prediction.
Right.
But there's no way around it. He got benched in crunch time this game. He got benched in crunch time on opening night. He barely played in crunch time in the second game. Coaching staff's basically telling him, you're not good enough right now.
Yeah.
And, you know, to play devil's advocate, he's done this in the past, and he tends to come around when he comes around. So it's not a, oh my God, he's awful type of thing. More of a just like, he's not playing well right now.
Yeah, good thing is they've got guys. They've got guys, I think, that can provide 80% of that value. Kuminga, I thought, wasn't great tonight, but he was still good enough. Moses Moody's been good enough, though he wasn't great shooting the ball tonight. But GP2 was a guy that picked up the slack tonight, right? Mm-hmm. So I tweeted that GP2 wasn't making any threes last game, and since then, he's pretty much not missed one. He went 3-for-4 from three tonight, even hitting one above the break off the bounce. So that's GP3. That's how you know GP3. That's how you know, like, he was locked in tonight. Dude's elite defensively. He has his way of, when he's coming back down defending in transition, he can still leap and try to block a shot. I haven't seen Prime Draymond is real good at it. You never see that from Draymond anymore because he's just older. But GP2 can do that in a way that I don't. Dude, it's crazy. I know the Rockets got some super athletic guys. Maybe Amen Thompson is the guy because he's defensively probably going to be elite. But none of the other athletic guys care about defense on that team. But GP2, I think. Sam, is he the best? Is he the best top three perimeter defender in the NBA? We do this every time, but I, is he top three?
Well, I think he's one of the best on ball defenders in the league. I think what's interesting is interesting is the wrong way to put it.
Help side.
He was this guy 2 years ago on the Warriors. Last year when they got him back from injury, he wasn't bad, but it was clear he was a little limited. It looks like he's back to being that guy, right? And that's a difference maker in general. I think that's the thing I want to take away from this. So let's pivot it. Like, yeah, okay, the starters didn't work well. You know what did work well? The second unit. Chris Paul, team high, plus 22. But in general, the second unit was plus 10. They were generally good. And Moody didn't hit shots tonight, but he played well. Kuminga, Saric, and GP2 was the guy who was best in that second unit. And I'm just looking at this team and I'm like, dude, they're deep. They're legitimately deep. They have a legitimate 10-man rotation. Last year, Wiggins would close even if he was playing poorly because, come on, man, you're going to close with Tony Lamb? I mean, they did anyway. But, like, you know what I'm saying? Sure, like, sure. They didn't have options. This roster, I think they have 10 legitimate options, and you can play the matchup. I could see games where Moses Moody closes. I could see games where Dario Saric closes. Saric, by the way, 5 assists, 8 rebounds. Like, he hasn't been hitting threes at the clip I thought he would to start the season, but everything else has been there offensively for him, right? Defensively, maybe not so much.
Yeah, so. I was going to say, but you got it. You got it, yeah.
And I think the takeaway from it is, look, man, this is – we'll see how high this team's upside is. You could be reasonable, and you could say, like, I need to see a little more. But I feel pretty good about this team's floor. Like, I see 10 really good players.
I'm with you on the floor. I'm with you on the floor. Like, this is a game. Let's, like, look at minutes distribution tonight. Steph is the guy that plays the most minutes at 31. Everybody else is under 30.
It's Spursy, isn't it? Like, where everyone's playing, like, kind of 20 to 27, right?
And that's the correct allocation of minutes, I think, especially a game like this. Well, you're playing the Houston Rockets in late October. Steph should not be playing 36 minutes. Like, that's what we saw from Steph last season, right? He's playing 38 minutes against the Rockets. He's having to throw up 25 shots, right? He's turning the ball over because he's trying to do too much. Like, it's what we saw from the Warriors last season. This, I think, is a lot better. So I'm with you on the floor things. I don't like what I've seen in terms of how good this team is going to be against better teams, just because, one, these guys are rusty, and two, I'm concerned about guys like Wiggins. I'm concerned about what can Chris Paul do against a better team. But you know, let's save that. Maybe even against tomorrow, New Orleans is undefeated. They look pretty good. Zion looks healthy for once. So, like, maybe we can save that for tomorrow night when we do this show. But I am a little concerned about how good they're going to be against better teams with these starters. But they definitely should beat some of these.
Are you really concerned? Like, this feels like concern trolling, because here's where I'm at with it. 2-1. They didn't have Draymond, one of their best players, the all of camp up until tonight. Yeah, they could do better. Guys could shoot better. There's a bunch of things to do better. But, like, I feel like attitude-wise, this team is building in the correct direction, and they're getting off to the start I want. Obviously, if shot-making and effort for certain players doesn't pick up in 20 games, I will change my opinion. But I feel like for a start to the season, I kind of like what I'm seeing.
Yeah. Yeah. I just, the stuff that the Warriors struggled with last postseason still kind of remain is all I'm saying, right? They still are going to need a wing guy to pick it up. And Wiggins hasn't been that guy, and maybe it's Wiggins, right? So net net just comes back to them. Let's just see 10 more games. All right. What do we got here?
Our guy Kirby asked this question. I want to bring it up on the chat.
Oh, I love this.
We need a name for the Chris Paul, Moses Moody, Saric, Kuminga, GP2, the second unit lineup. Should we call it Chris and the Kids? The Point Kids? The second starting unit? The Point God Disciples? CP and the Wings? By the way, the second starting unit is definitely what Fitz would call it. Fitz is going to start saying, we got two starting lineups.
Oh my! How did he not say that tonight? When Kerr went with the hockey
stones? Only a matter of time, my man. Only a matter of time. But I'm generally not a fan of hockey subs, but the way this roster is built, they can actually get away with it. Yeah. And they should mix and match. But I do love the way this lineup fits. Can we at least admit that? You know, you got Chris Paul as a point guard. GP2's a menace on the wings defensively. Moses is a shooter. Kuminga is a great power wing to attack the rim. And then Dario Saric is just a good stretch forward, can make extra passes and all that sort of stuff. It makes sense as a second unit. What are we calling this?
I'm not the most creative guy. You know this. I like CP3 in the wings. It makes sense to me. I love – so the CP3 and Saric stuff, I think, is – the two-man game is fun, right? But like – sometimes I'm like, oh man, it's just a lot of Saric. This is a lot. But I really love Moody, Kuminga, and GP. So I'm going with CP3 in the wings.
Mark in the chat goes old man in the three.
That's perfect.
I think I like that. I think that's the one I want to go with.
Coffee, right? That's good.
The replacements. I don't know. Who ask you guys? You guys email us, tweet at us, leave voicemail, whatever you want. What is the best nickname for the second unit? Because I like Chris and the Kids or CP3 and the Wings, but I'm not sold on it just yet. I need a little more.
We saw that lineup on opening night kind of make the change. I mean, make the wave that brought the team back from down 18, right? They did it again on the road, the first road game, and then they did it again tonight. There's something about, and Andre Iguodala was like this. I guess they're bringing Andre Iguodala's defensive instincts by putting Moody and Kuminga and GP2 out there so they can have that on the bench unit. But it's the ball handling, dude. Andre never turned the ball over. Andre always got the ball to the right person. Andre's not the type of ball handler that Chris Paul is, because Chris Paul is actually initiating offense. But even in transition, I've noticed one thing that I thought wasn't possible. Chris Paul doesn't actually hold the ball when he gets the ball in transition. He actually pushes the ball and makes the right pass. And it just always felt like he was guy who was going to be like, all right, we're just going to slow it down, kind of like the Luka, the James Harden. But he's not like that. That's not who he is at all.
You know what? Can we give Kerr credit for that? I think that's Steve Kerr. Because you're right. Chris, if you don't tell Chris Paul what to do, you're going to walk the ball off the court. You're going to run the Chris Paul offense, because that's like his instinct, right? I think the Steve Kerr, Chris Paul marriage actually brings out the best in the both of them in certain ways. And we're going to hear about Andre Iguodala all fucking season. And you know what? That's okay. We called it all off season that's what it would be, right? Let's not lie about it. We got this tweet from friend of the show, Shayna Rubin. Steve Kerr says, Chris Paul accepting roll off the bench is massive. Compares it to Iguodala in 2024. When I talked to him this morning, he nodded his head and said, let's go get him. It's not even that big a deal. I mean, dude, at some point, I just got to splice up the offseason takes. Like when we had like Spike Eskin on in the early part of the offseason, we were just all talking about it. We all know Steve's going to do this. there's going to be a game where Steph, I know Steph scored 40, but let me tell you how this game was won. When Chris Paul made that pocket pass to Trayce Jackson-Davis to settle us down in the second quarter, I know you only had 2, 2, and 2, but that was the game.
No, you're dead. You're not joking. You might be joking, but you don't need to be joking because that's exactly how this team – that's exactly what they needed, though. Do they win this game? Sam, let me ask you this. Do they win this game tonight if Chris Paul is not on the team and
Jordan Poole? Do they win this game if Jordan Poole's here?
That's exactly what I was going to ask. Exactly.
I would say it is unlikely that they win this game if Jordan Poole – or, like, doesn't that sum up the team? Like, Jordan Poole might score 40. Might go 10 for 15 with 8 threes. Or, you know, might go 7 for 24 and they lose, right? Like, it really – I think about what Steph said. All we had offensively was chucking threes. That's kind of all they were with Jordan Poole, right? It was like, if they're hot, they're going to win. If they're not hot, they're not going to win. They have no layers to their offense. Yeah. And I think to your point, which is, look, man, Steph and Clay can shoot it enough. We need the other guy to be someone who plays differently, because if it's just going to come down to hot shooting, I'd just assume get Clay and Steph 10 more shots.
Yeah.
You know, I'd rather they take 50 threes, the two of them, honestly.
Okay.
If we're just going to play that kind of basketball, I'd rather they just take 100 threes.
Yeah, I mean, that's and Clay looked good tonight doing it. But I know you got this video up. I'm gonna do a read before we get there. Oh, or we play it.
All right, play it real quick, and then we'll do a read after. A second.
Yeah.
Chris' early acceptance of coming off the bench, does that mean anything more overall to the team beyond just?
It's massive. It's massive the way Chris has embraced everything. You know, here in the first month since he's been with us. As you know, tonight was the first game of his entire career he didn't start. And, when I talked to him this morning about it, he just, nodded his head and said, let's go get him. You know, like, not even a big deal. So I think it's similar to Andre all those years ago, I guess 2014. When a vet, a great player, all-star, shows that kind of sacrifice, it just sets a tone for the whole team. And so the vibe is great on our team, and Chris is one of the main reasons for that.
The vibe is great. The vibe is great, huh?
It's like I spoke it into existence in the offseason. I could not be happier with the way this is going right now. They barely beat a crappy Houston team, but I'm not going to let anyone focus on that because it's early in the process.
Yeah, I agree.
You just wait, man. You just wait. This is there's something here, man. There's a little something here.
It's like football. Mm-hmm. You get a win. It's a win is a win. You know what I mean? Especially with a veteran team like this, a win is a win is a win. Just get the win and keep it moving, especially on the road. We know what the Warriors ceiling could be, and I think all that matters right now is you just keep the vibe. He literally said the vibes are good. Steve Kerr literally said the vibes are good. That cracks me up that he says that. It's usually that I feel like that's something a player says, but hey, shout out to Steve, man. He looks happy.
Should we rename this Vibes Are Back Pod? Vibes Are Back Pod.
That should be the title of the goddamn thing.
Well, I'm about to lose to our guy Tyler in Sleeper this week, so I'm pretty –
And well done. Are you guys using the Sleeper app for daily fantasy basketball? Or if you are like the Light Years podcast, like Sam and I, we are using the Sleeper app this season to play fantasy basketball. Sam, this is I am running all my fantasy leagues through Sleeper next season. I'm running that right now. This week I'm losing to Neil, who picked – the cool thing about Sleeper fantasy is that you get to pick – the game that you want to lock in from your player when you start them. Now, you have to make sure that you do it before the next game starts. But for example, this week when Steph dropped 41, I locked in that game, right? That was going to be the score that I got from Steph this week.
Unfortunately, I did not do that when Mikal Bridges put up a nice 25, 6-5. I was like, oh, he's going to do better. Mistake. And that is why I'm losing this week. But anyway, back to you, Andy.
I'm going to lose the same way because I did the same thing with Bam Adebayo. But outside of just season-long fantasy, can also do daily fantasy basketball. Tonight, for example, I took Anthony Davis and De'Aaron Fox on the totals. They're playing right now. Over is on points, rebounds, assists because the Kings don't play any defense. I should win that easily. That's free money for me. So if you think you know basketball, then try to turn your basketball knowledge into real money with the Sleeper app, the ultimate fantasy sports app that can turn game day into payday. So you download the Sleeper app, pick more or less on your favorite players, and with more stats than any other daily fantasy app, just choose two or more of your players from pregame or live. Pick more or less from the predicted stats, and you can win up to 100x your money if your picks win. Now, here's the fun part. You use promo code LIGHTYEARS, and you'll get up to $100 match on your first deposit. Terms and conditions apply. See Sleeper's terms of use for details. Again, promo code LIGHTYEARS, and you'll get up to $100 match on your first deposit.
Promo code LIGHTYEARS. Appreciate it, everyone. Sign up. Let us know what you're playing. We'll run some contests.
Let's go.
All right, my man. You know what's interesting? The Warriors are playing tomorrow night also. Usually when they play back-to-back, you know, we're not expecting this. But the word is they're intending to play their vets on both sides of the back-to-back, assuming health. I have no reason to not believe. That means Steph, Draymond, Clay, Chris Paul expected to play tonight in Houston and tomorrow in New Orleans. They played in Houston, just to be clear, as you all know. And as Andy pointed out, they didn't like play a lot of minutes at all. But what is your impression here on them playing both sides of the back-to-back in the early part of the season? Are we back to chasing wins? Are we chasing wins?
Well, you tweeted that this team is every other year team. One of my favorite 5-year stretches of sports is the 2010 Giants to the 2014 Giants, where they won the championship every other year, won three of them. I'm hoping the Warriors do the same thing here, where they only take the regular season and the season seriously every other year. Yeah, remember,
they're old, man. Steph needs a season to recover.
He just takes a season off. They seem like, we talked about this, you brought this up first maybe 2 months ago, the first 15 games of the season more important than any other stretch outside of the postseason for this team. Because if they can get off to a good start, the first 15 or 20 games, the rest of the season, it's set up for success for them, right? They're set up because they have good vibes. They understand the structure of what players need to be doing. That also means that players are also going to be playing better. It means Kuminga and Moody have been playing better, which is what we're seeing. It means Clay's been good, right? Which is what we're seeing. Draymond's now healthy. Really, the only thing that's worrisome now moving forward is probably 22. That's it. Because it seems like they've got the process, right, Sam? And part of that is actually fucking giving a shit during the regular season.
And just being committed to the process. Like, I'm not even sure I'm that worried about 22. It's dishonest to not call out that he's stinking up the joint, you know? Like, it is just what it is, right? When I look at the Warriors' schedule, like, we all know they have a heavy, heavy road schedule the first 10 games. They're in the midst of it right now. After that, they don't leave the Pacific time zone until, like, after New Year's. And to your point, they want to get off to a hot start. I'm wondering if, because they know that, you know, the schedule gets tough in January, but until then it doesn't. Like, go. Be 10-3. Be 20-8. Get to January 1st and be, you know, 21-9 or something like that. And then when you get into those hard road stretches, like what they have in the middle of January, which is like 6 games on the road with a bunch of back-to-backs, that's where rest is just going to have to happen because you don't have a choice.
Right. And that's also, it's January. So it's like, Memphis might be done by then. You know what I mean? Like, we don't know. Milwaukee just lost by 20 tonight. We don't know. So it's maybe they just spent too much time last season just kind of thinking about it.
Yeah.
Right. Versus, I mean, right now, they're just saying, let's go. Let's go, man.
Like, I mean, last year they lost back to back in Charlotte and in Detroit. Like, that could not be any more embarrassing. They're not losing in Detroit this year. They're not losing in Charlotte this year. Like, these are all, like, they're going to get out to the start they want to get out to, and we'll see. And to piggyback it, going back to it, like, only one guy played over 30 minutes tonight, and he played 31 minutes, and that was Steph Curry. I'm not worried about back-to-backs if everyone's playing 24, right, 20, 27 minutes. Yeah, obviously later in the season, things change. Chris Paul get banged up. Things, you know, like, it's not even like a a take as much as just his reality. If you go 10-11 deep on the regular, like, you don't really have to do as much resting. You have to rest when guys have to play 40 minutes a night, that sort of thing. So,
yeah. And then when that happens, get Pajemski out there. You know what I mean? Like, Moody could play more. Kuminga, although Kuminga's theoretically he could play more, but man, he's fouling a lot. So that seems a little weird.
Yeah, he needs to get under control a little bit. But
I think he's jacked up. I think that's what I don't think it's dumb fouls, really. I just think he's coming so hyped up and he's excited and he's playing well.
Good start to the season. Coaching staff's giving him confidence. And to your point, yeah, it's just a little too much, like, a little too much hype, a little too much pre-energy, a little too much pre-workout drink.
Dude, he's like 19, man. You don't need pre-workout. It's insane.
You shouldn't take it, dude. You don't need it. That's a point. That's a point. That's for Andy and me.
100%. I never understand why kids like in the early 20s drink coffee. Like, the fuck do you need coffee for?
When did you become a coffee drinker?
Dude, I 27, like 27, 28. I used to drink coffee when I was hungover. But like, if I wasn't hungover, to this day, I had half a coffee this morning. I'm amped up. Unfortunately, I had to watch football. But I didn't drink coffee till I was in my late 20s. How about you?
Early 20s. More of a 20. I didn't drink coffee until the end of my senior year when I was like probably doing too much in all aspects of life and I needed something to like just get me through it. But like I didn't really become a coffee, like wake up, make the coffee.
You're a coffee guy now, huh?
Of course I am.
Yeah.
Bro, I get woken up by a toddler, and the first thing I need is, like, I need coffee. Yeah. But I didn't become a daily coffee guy probably till like, 25, 24, something like that. You know, once I became a, like, clock it in at the office guy,
yeah,
every right. time, that that's really when that's when it started becoming a thing for me.
That really is it. That's the one, actually, where you start to need to – get in at 7:30. Francisco saying get a coffee sponsorship. Look, man, we're all up for sponsorships. Just let us know. We're always up for anything out there. We'll do it. We'll drop a promo code like yours for anything. You guys let us know if there is one.
Should we take a couple calls?
Let's roll.
Take a couple calls. Anyone wants to call in, you let us know. Hit the hand icon in the middle of the thing. We'll bring you up. Bring a Giosa up real quick. My number one hater.
Sir? You're muted if you're talking or if he's not. We're going to have to keep moving.
I took him off the stage, but you're still hearing it? As am I.
Right, he's finally gone. He's gone. Wow, that was rough.
Either in a bunch of traffic or watching some weird porn. Can't tell.
With the white noise? White noise? What? I never heard that one before.
Get my guy Tachyon up here. I know I can trust him.
Yes, sir.
Oh, that was hella funny. I can't even lie, man. Giosa, I love you, man. You're definitely a treat.
He's the man.
Oh, man. He's the man.
What's up, man? What do you got for us?
Nothing much. I'm just enjoying my life right now as a 49ers hater. So I'm just living the dream at this point.
Should we talk a little Niners?
Let's do it now.
Is this the transition we needed? Andy's like texted six different times, being like,
we don't really need to talk about the Warriors. Everything that we kind of said since the offseason came out true all today. Right. So,
all right. Well, you want to start us off, Tachyon? You want to start us off on the Niners?
I just wanted to let. I am giving you the floor because three game losing streak. So
yeah,
Gonna let you cook.
Can I ask both of you guys a question? Because you have a higher emotional stake in this than me. I'm more intellectually mistaken, which is a different issue. But where are you with Brock, with Kyle, with the defense? I feel like those are the three stakeholders we need to discuss.
Sure.
Okay, so first of all, I am a Raider, former Raiders fan, because that is a toxic relationship that I'm not getting back into. So I just hate the 49ers just because. But I will give my fair take on Brock. He is going through some struggles for sure. I didn't think that he was considered the top 10 quarterback during that 5-game winning streak. I didn't think that he was 25 compared to that one weirdo who considered him based on the ringer. But anyway, that doesn't matter. But anyway, he's going through some growing pains for sure. A little bit more tape is out on him. He's making some mistakes that were seen on film that are getting capitalized by the defense now. So it's kind of unfortunate, and I'm not going to give the concussion in the Vikings games too much of credit, because eventually he came back this week and the offense didn't look that great. A lot of preventable turnovers for sure, a lot of picks and a lot of fumbles. So it's probably just young QB shit that's been happening, and so he's probably going to have to grow from it. The defense, though, I think Vish was the one that said it before. It's like really hard to have an elite defense for like 5 straight years. And like
Vish said that, and I actually think about that all the time.
The Legion of Boom was like the one team that did that.
To be honest, yeah.
Yeah. But yeah. I'll let Andy cook with this one because he has more at stake with this.
Okay, so and by the way, that was a great point. I think about that with Vish a lot because I actually think that's true. It might not be his fault. So it's everyone's fault, right? It's not Brock's fault or just Kyle's fault or Steve Wilkes' fault or whatever. I think it's everyone's fault, but I do think maybe we can catch you on here. I do think that this team season's far from over, but I do think at some point this offense is going to be the one that has to carry this team if they want to win a championship, and I think that's what makes it tough. They can't go back. I think it's over. This defense is going to be elite. It's the number one defense. We're going to hold these teams to 10 points. We're going to hold Patrick Mahomes to 10 points through 3.5 quarters of the Super Bowl.
Oh,
I think it's obvious now that's done. I think the secondaries, they don't have a cornerback. Charvarius Ward is fine, but he's not great. Their slot corner is terrible. Hufanga hasn't made a play all year. And then Bosa's been absent all year, right? So they're trying to trade for a lineman in a corner right now to shore up the defense. So I think that's done. I think you can say against good teams, this offense is going to have to score 30 points. So if I had to pick someone to blame, probably Brock Purdy. You just can't throw picks like that, right? They cost this team 14 points tonight. They lost the game because of that.
One of them today was I can't defend it.
I mean, like, that's it, right? If it is – like, but to Tatchian's point, like, you can't – like, he's a young QB. He's going to have to grow through it. So this is going to be the stuff that happens. But if you were to pick someone to blame on, I don't think it's a defense. I don't think it's Kyle Shanahan. I think it's the guy that has lost a couple games. I guess you could throw Jake Moody in there because he literally lost his team a game. But mostly it's Brock Purdy, man. That's a lot of picks in a short amount of games, and it's hard. And let's see how he rebounds. I will say one thing about Brock, though. Even through these last three games, Sam, he's still way better than Jimmy G.
I get offended at the Jimmy G.
The turnovers are similar, but you watch him make plays with his feet. And then you watch him make throws down the field to Kittle and Ayuk today. That's not Jimmy. He's better. Now, is that good enough for them to win the NFC? I don't know. Like I said, the defense isn't as good as it was previously. The run game looks like it's not as good as it was previously as well. Trent's out tonight. So I don't know, but they need to have better offense. And you don't need Tebow out there to score 25-30 points every single game, right? So anyway,
this team's in the bottom 10 in quarterback pressure.
That's bad. And it looks like it. It should be the bottom 2.
Yeah, the teams that are below them are all the teams you would expect to be below them. I actually disagree with you. I think it's all in the defense. I think that who's the highest paid player on this team?
Bosa. Bosa.
Yeah. Yeah. Where is he? You know, like who are the best players on this team? It's Bosa, it's Trent Williams, It's Christian McCaffrey. It's Fred Warner. They have players across the board, more on the defensive side, in my opinion, than the offensive side. And I think the defense has been bad all year. And it's mostly the same cast they've had last year. I want.
So you're saying it's Steve Wilkes then? Is that what you're saying?
I don't know if it's Steve Wilkes. I'm not. I'm like
same players.
I mean,
maybe they're just worse.
That's the obvious, like,
right.
Okay, if it's the same players and they're not 35, it's the defensive coordinator.
Right, right.
I watched Brock walk it down the field and get him within a touchdown. And look, he played a terrible game, but Jimmy G is not doing that. And they have four Pro Bowlers on defense. And Joe Burrow did whatever he wanted just to fucking run the clock out. A good defense, a championship defense, is able to force a punt in that situation. And then if they actually force a punt there, then you and I can talk about if Brock is good enough. But no team's winning any Super Bowl without a defense that can get a stop.
Yeah. Water day today down 7. Brock threw a pick. It was over. Game was over.
It wasn't over then. They got it back.
They went down 14 with like 8 minutes left. The game was over.
He scored a touchdown to make it 17-24 with 8 minutes left. And the defense proceeded to let them walk it down the field and get to number 30, to get to 31. You're not winning a Super Bowl if a defense allows 30 easily. Period. I don't care what Brock did. You cannot allow 30 plus points and be a championship caliber team. It's like, it's like getting mad that, like, you know, the Warriors are turning it over too much. It's like, well, if you can't get stops, it doesn't matter. Like, some games you're going to get hot, some games you aren't. So I think they get their defense into it first, and then I'll talk about Brock. That's
why. You know how many points they've scored in the last three games? Average? Each game?
Sure.
17, right? If you are the smartest play caller in the existence of football, which is what everyone agrees with, you can't be scoring at 17 points a game. You come out the game and you run the ball three straight times. It's embarrassing. Run a play with Christian McCaffrey where he actually gets a ball to juke someone. He's not Nick Chubb. He's not running guys over, right? So you've got Christian McCaffrey's best running back. You've got Brandon Ayuk, who's pretty much one of the best wide receiver twos in the NFL, right? You've got George Kittle, who's a top tight end, right? You've got an unbelievable run game scheme. That's what I'm being told, and you can't run the fucking ball. So to me, it's not all
missing
on the
best. You're missing the best. I mean, it's just
to me, it's not all the defense fault. I agree with you that it is some of the defense fault. Kyle Shanahan's gonna have to figure something out, man. You can't just keep going out there and saying, "Let's just get Christian McCaffrey 30 touches." Oh no, CMC can't run it up the middle. What am I gonna do now? Right? Like, it's just 17 points.
The entire philosophy is to wear people out with physicality. If your defense isn't going to show up, it doesn't work.
The entire philosophy is that your offensive scheme is the best in the NFL. What are we talking about here? Their scheme scored 17 points.
They're still better offensively than they are defensively right now.
That's true. But the result is that they're scoring 17 points. They've lost three games. Each game they've scored 17 points.
Rick Walters is right. Enough. we'll get our guy Jivosa up here real quick. Give him one more shot. Hopefully he doesn't do that again. What's up, brother?
What's up? Am I, can you guys hear me?
Yeah, you're normal now.
Yeah. So I was going to say, right? So what was I going to say? Yes, I think I love our process. Like, I think we're deep. Like, I honestly think, like, we're sort of kind of, like, weird right now. It's still a bit rusty, like, with the starting lineup and all that. But, like, by game 25, like, I think we should be, like, almost, like, the best in the league. Almost, Nuggets. Yes. Because I don't really see, like, I don't see any, like, besides, I don't see any team in the West or the East besides the Nuggets that are actually good. Like, Bucks are not deep. Like, they're not deep. The Bucks are not deep. Lakers can't score. They're not deep either. Like, the Kings are the Kings. And the Clippers, like, kind of suck. The Suns are always hurt. Like, I mean, I think it's us and the Nuggets. And, like, and that's pretty much it. Like, that's by game 25, I think.
I like it. A positive Javasa.
I'm always positive, okay?
Wow. Dude, it's like a new leaf. We got to stop giving him shit because he's coming in locked in, dude. He's talking about the team being the best team. By the way, the Nuggets that he mentioned, you know what they did tonight?
They looked
good. They cooked up the Thunder, who everyone is saying, oh my God, they're the next best thing, they're the next best thing. And then they freaking drop 80 points on them in the first half. Nuggets are...
Jokic looks fucking good.
Nuggets are the best team in them.
Matthew, my man, what's up?
Some new... What's up, brother?
Yo. You know, so I think it's interesting because, like you guys said, it's obvious that they want to win. But I think that, like, last year, if we have these games that Steve Kerr wants to win, everyone's playing 30. Everyone's playing over 30. All the starters are playing, like, close to 40 minutes. Starts to get a little tight. He's like, all right, we got to get these starters back in. And he doesn't trust anyone off the bench. And obviously CP3 is part of the change of that. But I think that I just want to, you know, kind of like I said last time, Steve Kerr's starting to lean a little bit more on the younger guys, which I think is
Awesome. That's the way to go. It's pretty awesome, yeah. Matthew. Appreciate you, brother. We're getting more and more. You know, we'll see. I don't want to get too excited. I'm 100% expecting them to lose a game in the next 2 weeks, him to play Moses Moody 12 minutes, and then to go on in the podium.
Relax.
And the whole Mia Cole, I have to be better. I have to find more minutes for Moses. You know, like, but whatever. It hasn't happened yet, so who cares? We get a new caller up here. Here's Wildcat.
We got some new callers today, so we're trying to rip through it. Get to all of y'all. Okay, maybe not. Okay, maybe not.
Give another try. Because surely.
Oh, we do have Wildcat. Oh, we have Shirley. We do have Wildcat.
What's up, Wildcat?
All right. So the defense. I feel like last year the biggest problem with the team was just the defense and the lack of like versatile defenders. And already this year we've held pretty much every team like under 110, around 110, which in the modern NBA is pretty fire. So just curious what you guys think about the defense. And the other thing too, when the playoffs come around, I feel like we need, you know, in the early 2000s, you need bigs like to guard Shaq. I feel like we need bigs, at least another big or two to guard Jokic. Like, bro, the Nuggets today. Oh my God.
I give you that. Appreciate the call, Wildcat. So I will say, I don't know if you agree with me, Andy. You're on mute, by the way.
Go, Sam. Go. Sorry.
I was going to say Looney guards Jokic as well as anyone in the league, which isn't to say he shuts him down. I'm just saying, like, Jokic is Jokic, right? I still think the Looney-Draymond combo is about as good as you can find at guarding him, right? Maybe they need another big just to, like, keep the fouls down. But I'm not worried about bigs just yet. I think the way you beat Jokic is by putting pressure on him on the other side of the floor.
So first off, he brings up the defense, which I don't think we've talked about enough. So I thought that was great. That's not something we're totally locked in on, but they talked about this defense being a top five defense again this season. So far, I think, especially tonight with Draymond out there, they certainly look like it. The other part is, who the hell are you bringing out? Who are you getting that is going to be guarding Nikola Jokic? Are the Warriors going to trade for are they going to trade for prime Tim Duncan to guard Jokic? Are they going to trade for prime Kevin Garnett? Are they getting Bill Russell, who I've never watched play, but are they getting him? Can they get Wilt Chamberlain? I know he's a Warriors great. There's nobody that the Warriors are going to get that is going to do anything that Draymond and Jokic, Draymond and Looney can't do, to your point. They're just going to have to play some shootouts with him and see if they can just get enough defense on the wings, maybe make Michael Porter be maybe make him drive, right? Maybe make Aaron Gordon the guy that Draymond plays mind games against to make, like, that's the way that you're going to have to defend this team. There's nobody that's going to say, yeah, me and you, Jokic, let's go one-on-one. Because last I checked, Anthony Davis tried that, and we saw what happened.
He got put through the basket. No, yeah, I mean, it's all right. All great players, it's about can you deter the ball to other players. It's not stopping. You're not stopping.
Same with Steph.
Yeah.
Who are you getting to guard Steph?
Every defense that stops Steph just puts eight guys on him to get the ball out of his hands. Oh. It's really that simple. Yeah. We're going to end it with McWalters, the closer. Calling him in. Should I play the trumpets?
Oh, we do have one more new caller. Maybe she's out.
Yo. What's up, everybody?
We got the Hawaiian shirt on too.
Sunday fun day.
I'm down here. I'm down here in the danger zone of LA for a while, and all I have is Hawaiian shirts, so stuck. But anyways, improvement from last year. We did the same type of road trip. Did I hiccup on you? The internet here is terrible. Sorry about that. I was just saying that we had this exact same road trip last year and followed up with a 40-point stinker in New Orleans. And I guarantee you that ain't going to happen this time around because we played everyone, our starters, about 5 to 7 minutes less than we did last year to barely eke out this game for our first win on the road last year. And I think that's something to kind of keep in mind, that Kurt did a really good job balancing it out. If you look at last year's box score, it was the starters and nothing. And then we just got shellacked in New Orleans. And I think we're going to come out tomorrow, and I think it's going to be one, hey, payback from last year. We don't lose by 40 like that. That is embarrassing. And then I wouldn't be surprised if we get out to a really hot one on them and just kind of blow them out of the water, and we see little pods and a little action from our rookies. So.
Let's get it.
Hey. Okay, we're gonna get McWalter back tomorrow. Good mood Walter, you know what I mean?
McWalter's always in a good mood. He's a man of the people, you know?
All right. Last one.
What's up, guys?
All right.
What do you – just thinking, now that Draymond's back – I didn't watch the game too much, but now that Draymond's back, do you think that it'll help Clay, get good looks and also help him defensively so he's not that low man on the help side?
I like this question.
More rim protection, What do you think about that? And also last thing, crazy Steph is still doing this, 35. Let's never take it for granted. All right.
It's still 30s league. That's my line for the entire season. I'm just going to remind people all year, it's still 30s league. I don't care what anyone else says. It's still 30s league. It's been his league for a decade. It's still his league. It will always be his league. That's a good point. I do think actually Draymond returning helps Clay more than anyone.
I thought you were going to finish on the Steph. I thought that was perfect. That was beautiful. With Draymond, everything's so much easier defensively. I'm not just sitting there about to shit my pants every time someone gets to the rim, right? I know Fitz brought this up, so I hate to be a guy that's agreeing on Fitz here, but when Şengün gets the ball when they run a pick and roll and Şengün tries to back down Draymond, that's when I'm sitting there going, let's go. That's perfect. That's perfect for the Warriors because that's going nowhere. Right? That thing's going nowhere. Şengün's going to pull up a forced fadeaway or he's turned the ball over. Draymond's guarding multiple guys, especially against young teams like this. So he's rusty offensively. You can tell with some of the turnovers that he had. But I can't wait for tomorrow. Like McWalter said, let's go. We'll be back tomorrow post-game.
We will be back tomorrow. We'll end that. I want to throw out also, helps Clay get going offensively. Draymond knows where he'll be. And, Clay's looking good offensively. I liked what I saw tonight.
He's back, baby.
We're going to leave it there. Appreciate everyone. Good evening.